Good, let's proceed. So it's a great pleasure to have Fabian Heidrich-Meisen here from LMU Munich, and he will talk about spin and heat transport in quantum magnets.
Okay, yeah, thank you, Dirk. Yeah, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to come here. It's been very interesting listening along to talks from a completely different community where similar terms appear. Here we're switching gears now away from definitely from systems that maybe are quantum or maybe classical, to definitely systems that are in the quantum regime. So the materials that we have in mind are quantum magnets mostly. And in this talk, maybe I'm going to try to convey two or three main messages. The first one is that in low-dimensional quantum systems, where spin is 1/2 typically, on top of that, there is a version of supercurrents, an abuse of the term, and I'll try to show you theoretical evidence and a bit of the experimental data for that. And experimentally, as we will see, there is a relatively a common feature when you measure thermal conductivities, namely that various types of spin excitations, spinons, magnons, triplet excitations, can dominantly contribute to thermal transport in these systems and even exceed phonon contributions. Okay, so, So this is work that, somehow a topic that I've been working on for a long time. That's why there's a lot of people. The most recent work that I'll actually be presenting at the very end of the talk is together with Christoph Karasch, Joel Moore was partly involved, and Dante Kennis from Aachen, two of my former students who have now both left LMU. And then we had a long-standing collaboration with experimentalists from quantum magnetism who have done many of the measurements of thermal transport. I will very briefly also tell you that the same kind of questions that we've been looking at here theoretically in connection with spin and heat transport can also be looked at in optical lattices. And there we had a collaboration with the Manuel Bloss group, and there's a nice experiment that I will tell you very briefly about as well. And then there's many other people over the couple of years that I've collaborated with here. So that's to acknowledge that. Now, the type of Hamiltonians that we're looking at are Heisenberg Hamiltonians, spin 1/2. We're going to be mostly looking at 1D. There's a little bit of 2D, at least in the experimental part. And if you're familiar with that field, then you probably know that there are some principal exact solutions for these type of models. So it goes back to Beta-Ansatz. There is bosonization or other field theories that provide you with insights into the universal behavior at low energy scales. And then there is numerical techniques that very often work the most powerfully in 1D. And for that reason, there is very often a great agreement when you compare experimental theory when it comes to thermodynamics, or when you measure neutron scattering data that is shown here in this right corner here for typical spin 1/2 material. So here you see again this the two spinon continuum that appeared earlier today in the talk by Saito. And if you do numerical calculations or calculations using Beta-Ansatz, you can almost reproduce fine details of this novice current technology. So it just turns out that one of the harder problems to get a handle on theoretically really is transport at finite temperature in these systems. And the reason is essentially it turns out to be non-universal. The qualitative properties when it comes to spin and heat transport and spin systems depend actually on the specific Hamiltonian. That's a bit unusual. And that's one of the topics that where you will still see many papers from the theory side on this particular model. And the other topics that are slightly related are non-equilibrium dynamics and then more recently work on disorder and MDL. So for us, the goal here is to basically understand the spin conductivity. And what we will see is that in many of these systems, there's not only like a standard incoherent background that would give rise to a standard DC conductivity and hence diffusion, but there can also be very unusual low frequency contributions that may even diverge completely. Okay, so here's an overview over the experimental system. So most of the experiments really come from quantum magnetism. This is a material that realizes both spin chains and ladders. Then optical lattices have become a player. I mean, there's various ways that you can use ultra-cold quantum gases in optical lattices to essentially emulate spin Hamiltonians. And I will show you one example. And then more recently, there's people from the atoms community with STM techniques that can arrange atoms on surfaces. And there's some work that shows that one can explain the observations essentially with Heisenberg type of Hamiltonians. Here they are typically limited to right now 12 spins or so. Yeah, but there's a broad range. that vary, of course, in terms of what you can measure and how you can manipulate these systems, but there's slightly related questions in all of these fields. Okay, so the outline will be that, first of all, let me again emphasize, we're in the quantum regime, we're dealing with a strongly correlated system, so there's dominant many-body interactions. We're in 1D, there is no quasi-particle picture, yeah, so we have collective excitations. And the main theme that has drawn many theorists into this game and has also stimulated experimentalists to improve their crystals is that in certain types of these Hamiltonians, that the Heisenberg chain is one of them, there is kind of unusual conservation laws beyond just energy and particle number that very often happen to be currents, and we'll see examples. And because of that, because of this exact these exact conservation laws, the related conductivities can be strictly divergent. Yeah? And then you can play the game of how stable such situations are against going away from these very particular Hamiltonians, going to more generic situations. You can ask whether this has any connection to actual real materials, and so on and so forth. Okay, so I spent a good deal of time talking about introduction and showing you experimental data from both measurements on quantum magnets and on optical lattices. Then I'll talk a little bit about our own work and the state of the art when it comes to understanding specifically spin transport in this one model that I wrote on here. And then at the end I'll tell you in just 5 minutes about what we're actually working on these days in this context, so transport on spin ladders, the Hubbard model in 1D, and also including phonons. Okay, so this the first two slides are going to be basically an introduction into the theoretical motivation that is the reason why most theorists work in this field. We are studying this problem on the level of linear response, and then essentially you have to calculate current autocorrelation functions. Everything is at finite temperature again. And then in linear response, you typically decompose conductivities into, you know, a well-behaved part plus a delta function contribution at zero frequency. And that thing is usually called Drude weight, in resemblance to Drude theory that you know from the basic introductory courses in condensed matter. Now, the simplest situation, just think of non-interacting electrons, is that the current, let's say the electrical current, in that case will obviously be conserved unless there's disorder or something. And then indeed you get a situation where this is the only contribution, and then the common ideas that we teach students is that you have this delta function contribution, you turn on coupling to external degrees of freedom, even if you have, that would also be a situation in a Fermi liquid, and then that broadens the delta function, and in this case everything that you measure is completely dominated by external scattering mechanisms. And that's essentially somehow the same thing that happens here, it's just that both of these contributions can be present typically. But we'll see that in these one-dimensional models, indeed, there can be, if I write down pure spin Hamiltonians, there can be a divergent contribution, and that means that probably experimentally we'll purely see the effect of scattering, external scattering processes, so either it's impurity scattering or coupling to phonons. Okay, so that's possible to have these finite ballistic contributions, as they usually refer to divergent DC conductivities at finite temperatures. And that would mean that if you do the Gedanken experiment where you imprint a spin current in some Heisenberg Hamiltonian, then turn off whatever force you use to imprint that current, then in a situation where both of these contributions are there, then that will relax a little bit, that's controlled by this part, and then ultimately settle into a non-zero value that will not go away. So it's kind of a super current to make the connection.
So it's a finite system or infinite system?
Well, in principle, it's infinite system. In principle, that's a statement about the infinite system.
Otherwise, the current will have a problem, right?
Well, if you have a periodic boundary condition, right. Yeah, we're talking bulk, then yeah. But you can do the experiment precisely on a ring. Yeah, you can really do that. People did that just for demonstration. And then you see that in this model, even at finite temperature, you imprint the current and it doesn't go away. Yeah, so that's really the quantum quench problem that you can do. But it's not the usual persistent current that you look at very low energy scales, but it's really a phenomenon that can that lives at any temperature in these systems.
In the way the quantum effect also comes out of classical spin models?
No, I think there is no. I think it's a quantum effect because there's probably no. Well, you can probably have, of course, ballistic classical models, I believe. The reason why we have that is, of course, the the quantum mechanical structure of the many-body wave function in this case, or the, you know, the solution to these quantum mechanical problems that are rooted in these particular conservation laws. So you can have ballistic classical systems, but the reason here is related to particular quantum mechanical structures of these Hamiltonians. Yeah? But the phenomenon is such, okay, you can that things like that you can find in other situations.
So is this, does this apply to beta-ansatz solve? Beta-ansatz solve the spin models, they have a finite dual wave, or are there non-beta-ansatz solve models which have a finite dual wave?
No, that's not known. Yeah? So in a more theory language, indeed, the only systems that support that, or that can support that, because we will see that that not all currents behave the same way in these models. If I take spin 1/2 Heisenberg chains, then we'll see in the next slide that actually that's the canonical example, that in this case the thermal conductivity is strictly of the form that you only have a Drude weight, and that's because the related current operator itself is a conserved quantity. That's really related to the algebraic structure of the beta-ansatz solution. So here one of the conserved quantities that these people construct is already the energy current itself. And then all you can calculate is really the temperature dependence of this thermal Drude weight, and that was done 15 years ago, and it's shown here, so it has a linear slope. Because you have spinon excitations here, then there's a typical maximum that is somehow shifted from where the specific heat sits, and then it goes down. And the other example, the other canonical example would be the Hubbard model. Yeah, that's also a system that has ballistic energy transport. The interesting questions are mostly related to spin and charge transport, because that's a bit more complicated. Yeah, but to answer the question, I don't know any model that has this behavior that is not beta-ansatz solvable. Yeah. Okay, so that's the canonical example. And these things were somehow known for a long time, but then put into context in this paper in 1997 for the first time, where this connection to conservation laws, and in particular this one, was made clear by Zotos and collaborators. And then later on, the experimentalists started to look into that. And I'm going to show you examples going from essentially all anorganic materials, cuprate-based materials, going from a system that realizes a double chain here that's a relative of the material that we saw earlier today in Saito's talk, to the spin ladder materials, and then ultimately to 2D, which are the parent compounds here, or one of the parent compounds for the HTC superconductors. And if you measure thermal conductivity, then you kind of see the same pattern in all of these curves. So this is thermal conductivity as a function of temperature. And the important curves are the red ones. So that's what you get when you measure along the direction of the one-dimensional structure of the spin system here. That's along the ladder direction, and that's in plane in the 2D material. And all the other contributions here, this black stuff here, then the blue line here, and that is basically what you measure in the conductivity perpendicular to the direction of the spin structure. And you see the effect is actually, so there's first of all this anisotropy in all of these systems. Then it's also interesting to really look at the numbers. So this is 800 watt per Kelvin and meter, and that puts these systems, it's almost a practically perfect electrical insulator, and it puts actually among the best 15 thermal conductors that you can find. Yeah? Of course, these are very difficult crystals to work with, as we have heard today. So it's not immediately clear how to put that to any kind of use, but the numbers are strikingly large. Yeah? Okay. They go down a little bit when you go from strictly 1D to a ladder structure, two couple chains to 2D, which is maybe a bit misleading because you have to kind of account for the effect of this specific heat that depends on density of states that is different as you go along this direction. And one way of putting numbers to this whole effect that people like is to essentially just divide out specific heat and the characteristic velocities here and to extract something like mean free path. And in this particular material here, that's of the order of 1 micrometer. You know? So that means that you have that essentially, you know, heat currents are transported almost dissipationless over macroscopic distances. Okay, so that's the experimental observation somehow. And here, this is an example. So you see there's two papers, there's these numbers that indicate the purity. And as I said, if we believe in the story that in these strictly one-dimensional systems we should have divergent thermal conductivities, then as an experimentalist you try to get rid of all of the external scattering mechanisms, and here they made super pure samples, and that's why this red data is so much higher than what was originally seen here in the 2N sample. So that's quite some progress on the sample preparation side.
Is it mostly spin-on?
Yeah, so that's the idea, right? So the, in most of these materials, the phonons are essentially isotropic, yeah, and then you attribute this contribution here to spinons.
Isotropic, despite this yeah. Like light material.
Yeah, but still, when you measure the phonon dispersion, the anisotropy that you see cannot account for these differences. Okay. Yeah? Okay. And I think the most striking evidence for the fact that we really see contributions from spinons or triplet spin-1 excitations. So this system has a gap. This is gapless. This is again essentially, you know, marknons on top of an anti-ferromagnet with a small gap in the spectrum. So it's different type of spin excitations. But the most convincing experimental evidence is when you start to do doping series. Yeah? So you bring zinc into the system that typically replaces copper. It takes away a spin, and then you can selectively affect what we believe is the spin contribution.
So yeah, is it kind of generic expectation that in a pure crystal, the spinons tend to dominate in this copper oxide compounds?
Now, why they dominate, that's a good question.
But experimentally, that's sort of...
Yeah, that's the observation.
That's pretty much a standard.
Well, I think it's a, I would say it's a it's an observation in these cuprate-based materials, in these anorganic systems.
Yeah, cuprate-based, copper oxide.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But then, of course, there's many other 1D systems in organic systems.
It's really for copper oxide.
Yeah, so here it seems kind of relatively relatively common effect. Yeah. It varies a bit, of course, in the magnitude. Okay, so then usually I'd say at this point, okay, we have definitely you know, magnetic contributions to the thermal conductivity. Spin transport is usually not seen, and the only way to access that is via NMR, which probes different wave vector dependencies. So this is steady state, and this would be at Q equal pi typically. It's much more difficult to interpret that, and it's also a different correlation function. But then we heard this talk tomorrow from Saito, who says now that there is spin Seebeck effects in a close relative to the material. So I actually had to change my last slide. I had this as an outlook. Apparently, there's new stuff now. So, but that has been somehow a goal in the field to see really spin transport and maybe drive spin transport by using magnetothermal effects, which is a word that we use for instead of spin Seebeck effects. And previous experiments have failed to see that, but now there is apparently progress. Okay, so then people started to daydream. Since we have these large mean free paths, you can try to cook up different schemes, so you different ways of measuring, not only measuring steady state, but also things like heating up a sample and then measuring what comes arrives at the other end, and various things like that have been done. Here's an example that I like personally a lot. This is spin ladder materials again. Here they are shining with a laser on top of the surface, and then there's a fluorescent layer on top of that. And here the ladders are aligned in this direction. Here they're sticking out of plane, and you see the same anisotropy. Yeah, so now you have various ways of measuring the same thing. This is in real time, real space. We saw steady state. And I think tomorrow you will hear about other techniques, maybe not applied to the same materials, from David Cahill's talk. So this anisotropic dynamics is seen in various types of experiments. Okay, so now when we talk about these systems, you can never really avoid worrying about phonons, because when you heat up the sample, then you first talk to phonons typically. The phonons talk to spin, this is to the spin system. So ultimately, to have a complete description, you have to worry about electron-phonon coupling. That's much harder, of course, and I will not say much about theoretical work on that, so I'll have to refer you to other people. But then the question is, can this effect of having strictly dissipationless transport in a 1D model, can this be seen at all in any kind of experiments? So here's an example that now comes from a bosonic ultra-cold quantum gas in an optical lattice in one dimension. Here they trap these potassium 39 atoms in the lowest band of an optical lattice. They start from a state where there's exactly one boson per side, and then this is faithfully described by a Bose-Hubbard Hamiltonian hopping of bosons and then Hubbard interactions, and then a trapping potential that is then turned off to let the particles move around. And this is the really simplest way of doing quantum magnetism with ultra-cold quantum gases, because when I make U over J large and go to density 1, then that's nothing else but the XY model. So the XY model is a very trivial example of an exactly solvable model, because this just maps via Jordan-Wigner to spinless fermions. So as a theorist, you know immediately that you expect ballistic transport, and this experiment shows exactly that. So you let these bosons expand. This is non-attracting bosons, so they spread out ballistically. This is experimental data, that's numerics. And then when you go to very large U over J, then you recover precisely the same density profiles that you see for non-interacting bosons, because these very strongly interacting bosons here map to non-interacting fermions, and then you can't distinguish by looking at density whether you have non-interacting fermions or bosons. Now, so here it's real non-interacting bosons. Here, the strongly interacting system just maps onto non-interacting effective fermions. And then you can perturb away from this particular point by going to 2D, which was done in the experiment, and then you see that these fast non-equilibrium expansions go away, so this is a particular singular point. Okay, so that has in principle been seen. What has not been done is really to probe that in linear response. Okay, so let's see. Yeah, so now I want to use a couple of slides to tell you, you know, what the theorists in this field are struggling with and what the state of the art is in terms of calculating the much more complicated quantity, namely spin transport, even though there's not so many ways yet of measuring it experimentally beyond these quantum gas experiments and the Spin-Seebeck effect that we heard about in the morning. So now we're looking at a slight generalization of a spin 1/2 Heisenberg model, allowing also for an exchange anisotropy. The reason is again that this is essentially maps to non-interacting fermions, and this is then the term that brings interactions into the system in the many-body language. And if you go away from the special point where delta is zero, then the spin current is never a conserved quantity. So unlike the thermal current, this guy is never a conserved quantity, and it's essentially given by this term locally. So in this model, we are going, as we tune this parameter, through a Luttinger liquid phase in the ground state and then to a gapped antiferromagnetically ordered easing-like phase as a function of delta. And in the ground state, that's a very old result. When you calculate the Drude-Wade in the ground state, it just tells you that, you know, this has metallic behavior, so the Drude-Wade is finite, and here it's zero because it's an insulator. And now the essential question that has driven people mad for 20 years is to understand how this extends to finite temperatures. And I'll tell you what the answer is in this slide. So that's the result of our work and also many other people's work. So what turns out to be the picture is that exactly delta equals zero, you have this naive ballistic conductor because you have non-interacting particles. If you stay in this on top of this Luttinger liquid, then it turns out that this is the correct picture. You still have a sizable ballistic contribution, but also finite frequency contributions. And here the interpretation is that the spin current is not completely conserved, but it has a projection onto a conserved quantity, and that projection remains finite and makes the whole dynamics non-ergodic. So that's the correct picture here. There's still some debate about the fine details of the sigma of omega structure here. Then if you go to very large delta, then it turns out that in the same model, just by tuning interaction strength, you can go to a very standard diffusive conductor. Yeah, so in that sense, not the correct statement is the beta ansatz models are the ones that are prone to possibly have ballistic transport, but it may depend on specific parameters. Yeah? So here this would be, in this case, wrong direction. So this would now be a regime in which we have dissipationless heat and spin transport. And then this regime is, I find that very appealing because now you have a situation in which you still have dissipationless heat transport at finite temperatures, but diffusive spin transport. So kind of the most extreme violation of any Wiedemann-Franz law that you can think of. Yeah?
It sounds really odd.
Do
you have an intuition how to think about it?
No, because it's, so to speak, intuition is hard to come by. I think the only understanding really goes to mathematically understanding the conserved quantities and checking whether they have overlap with conserved quantities or not.
This is just plain XXZ model.
Yeah, it's plain XXZ model. Now, what is the most embarrassing statement is that we still don't know what's going on exactly at the Heisenberg point. So here, I'll show you a little bit of data in a second. Here, most people believe that it's not ballistic, but it's probably also not diffusive. So this looks like a super diffusive conductor, which would mean it still has a divergent DC conductivity, but just not a finite Drude Wade. So, you know, it's a very simple model, and transport seems like such an obvious thing to calculate, and it's extremely rich in its behavior. But I like this because, in essence, if you speak in the language where you talk about certain excitations carrying spin and heat, and that's the language that mostly you're using in your talks, obviously, because that's the standard picture, then here you have a situation where the same kind of carriers have dissipation at heat transport, but diffusive spin transport.
Is this ferromagnetic or antiferromagnetic?
The materials are antiferromagnetic. The theoretical statements do not depend on the sign.
What happens, delta equals 1 is a quantum critical point.
Yeah.
What exactly happens?
Well, this is, well, Well, so we are really talking about finite temperature properties. If you look into the ground state, that's all a Luttinger liquid. This one here picks up, you know, if you know Luttinger liquid theory, there's marginal terms that become marginally relevant. So there's typically logarithmic corrections in the thermodynamics at this particular point that are absent here. But since these effects really exist at any finite temperature, it has nothing to do with the low energy theory in reality. So it's really encoded in the structure of many-body wave functions or in reality. Yeah? So it's not something that you can capture.
There's no phase transition, nothing, right?
So no, there's no, absolutely. No. Even
nevertheless, you have this really strange
jump in the transport. Yeah, and the okay, I'll say half a word about what how people understand that, but let me maybe show you one calculation. So what we are doing is, precisely because the transport properties are kind of non-universal, we want to be unbiased, so we're using density matrix minimization group simulations. What it does is the following. It is typically a wave function based technique, but you can also do simulations at finite temperature and then calculate in real time finite temperature current autocorrelation functions, and somehow it's become fashionable to look at that in real time. And here's three examples now as a function of this delta here. This is the case where you have clearly non-attracting particles, so you know this function never decays. This is a typical case where you have some short-time dynamics and then you settle in into a non-ergodic value that is exactly this Drude weight. And this number here is known analytically. And then at delta equal 1, you see, okay, the curve doesn't show any clear indication of either saturating or going to zero. And that's a bit the dilemma because we don't have methods that take us to t equal 1,000.
Is this now a Luttinger liquid-like behavior or?
No, because because there's other Luttinger liquids in 1D, so if you perturb it around this particular model, I mean, you can add nearest neighbor interactions and cook up a zigzag chain, then you're still in the Luttinger liquid phase, but the transport properties change completely. So heat transport immediately becomes, in second order perturbation theory becomes dissipative. So it's really, that's why I'm saying it's non-universal, it's really microscopic models that give rise to this behavior.
So you would say then that the Luttinger liquid picture is wrong for this?
That's why I call transport is non-universal, and it's very hard to get the correct theory in Luttinger liquid theory, precisely because the conservation laws exist on the lattice level, and once you go to the continuum limit, you lose the information about precisely that. So all the crucial information is in terms that you've thrown away along the way. And then you can do the standard things that Giamacchi did a long time ago. You take a Luttinger liquid, you add Umklapp scattering, and you get a standard diffusive behavior depending on regimes. And then Zirka and Affleck refined the Horn analysis. But the problem is really you cannot a priori tell within the Poissonization whether there is funny conservation loss or not. And that's another very interesting open question that I think Ian Affleck is still banging his head about to solve that. Yeah.
So is it impossible to extract information from the beta ansatz for this correlation function?
So as I said, we're doing this kind of numerics because that's unbiased, and then there's of course experts for beta ansatz who have been working on that, but the problem is mathematically so hard, much harder than thermal transport, that the progress there happens over time spans of 10 years. So. And so I think next year there should be a new paper from Wuppertal, from Andreas Klümper's group, but it's a very hard mathematical problem. I can talk to you more about my understanding why that is. Okay, so then just to give, I still have 5 minutes, I guess. Let's check. Yeah. Well, I still have roughly a couple of minutes. Okay, let me skip that. We can now calculate temperature dependencies of Drude weights. And to give credit, it's been a puzzle to really pinpoint down the one conservation law that is responsible for this ballistic spin transport. And Thomas Prosen, who's a statistical physics expert and a mathematical physicist from Ljubljana, solved the whole problem, and he found a conserved quantity that previously was completely unknown in the beta ansatz theory. It has a different structure, and that guy is the one that produces a finite overlap with the spin current, and then this gives. There's an equation that gives you a lower bound for this ballistic contribution, and that lower bound vanishes exactly at delta equals 1, 0 in the entire massive phase. Yeah, so that's That's the mathematical answer to the question what happens as you cross this particular point. It is related to the existence of bound states in the spectrum, yeah, that exist on one side and don't exist on the other side, and that's somehow what this guy measures. Okay, so that's the ballistic regime. Then you can also look at the delta larger than one regime, and then let's just look at this red curve here. That's again the same current correlation function. Now you see it decays relatively rapidly, oscillates a little bit, and now you can just integrate that curve. That's essentially a DC conductivity or the diffusion constant, and that's something that now we have, you know, some numerical handle on to get the diffusion constant here at least at high temperatures. Yeah? So, but that's a completely different behavior from the behavior that you see, that you've seen here. And that's why this model is so particularly rich. Okay, then let me maybe skip these things. Here we have been looking at the same problem now in real time, in real space. So you just create a little perturbation in the spin density or heat density and let it spread out, motivated by these kind of things. And then you study the widths, which you can relate back to the conductivity or diffusion constant via Einstein relations. And if you look at the widths, then here again in this in the for large values of delta atop the Ising regime, you see heat transport is always perfectly ballistic, and spin after some time settles in to grow linearly this time, so that's sigma squared, and that's diffusive behavior. So that would be the kind of experiment that we hope someone to set up. The best bet right now is probably ultra-cold quantum gases, probably not with spin systems, but with Hubbard models, which are much easier for them to deal with, and that would be nice to see that in the same model you can have completely different, qualitatively different transport behavior. And the timescales to see that are not long. Yeah, that's precisely the timescales that optical lattice people can resolve. Okay, so one word about ongoing research. So all of that was, yeah, 2 minutes was stuff that we've been doing until recently. So now I said you can also cook up different models. So now we are leaving these particular integrable models and look at systems that have a more generic behavior. Here's an example of a zigzag system that I think Oleg will maybe touch upon tomorrow. This has a very rich phase diagram as a function of field and the ratio of J1 over J2, the nearest and next nearest neighbor coupling. There are certain phases that are single component Luttinger liquids, two component Luttinger liquids here. There's a, you know, an insulating phase, if you wish, a plateau phase. And what we were interested in is this particular phase up here, where on each bond, this quantity has a finite expectation value that's called vector chirality. The reason is that the dispersion in this region has two minima, and then you can break the Z2 symmetry associated with that, and this can become actually finite, so it's true long-range order. And we had some arguments to guess that thermal conductivity should be large in this phase, and that's somehow supported by this numerical data here. So this is essentially low temperature, low frequency response in the thermal conductivity that is large here, but it's also large below. This is still finite system sizes, so we're trying to back this up as larger systems. And that's something that we're thinking about right now. It's interesting because this model is so particular, rich with all these phases, and there's really relatively little experimental access to observing any one of them. Now, of course, the materials are much more difficult. They're not usually strictly one-dimensional, but that's something that we like right now. It kind of started during a 2015 SPICE workshop, and that's why I wanted to show it to you. Okay, so then let me just wrap up, show my summary. What I really wanted to tell you is that, yes, there is a large magnetic contribution to heat transport in these antiferromagnetic quantum magnets. The theory tells you that there can be dissipation of spin and heat transport. The stories are a bit more complicated. And what I find appealing is that in the same model, you can have coexistence of ballistic heat transport and diffusive spin transport. And here's my list of open questions, and that I added in this morning when I saw the preprint, that the spin Seebeck now apparently has been seen in the systems. Thank you.